Good morning.
Good to see everybody here. Ready to stand and sing? All right, let's stand and sing.
Thank you.
Again this morning, I'm going to try to do my best imitation of RJ's unique ability to make announcements. It is good to see you here. By the way, RJ is off preaching this morning, so just pray for him as he preaches that God will use him in a powerful way in the proclamation of the gospel. Again, welcome, Family Fellowship. Welcome, guests. We are so thankful to our Father that you're here. And it is always our prayer that you will experience God's presence in this place. And that you'll be able to leave here this morning saying, truly the presence of the Lord was here. That I'm not the same person that I entered the doors, as I entered the doors, but changed and different. If you are a first-time visitor or have not previously filled out a visitor's card, would you do that one small favor? You'll find those cards in front of you there in the pew. Fill it out as completely unique as you wish. And then at the end of the service, you can just drop it in the offering plate in the back. And I thank you in advance for doing so. Oh, by the way, considering offerings. I like the way RJ says that. We no longer take an offering. Well, that's not quite right. That's why I know a lot of you come here, because you think, well, I don't have to give. Jesus paid it all. But the rest of that says, all to him I owe. So, we do not pass the offering plates, but if God lays in your heart to give, we do have offering plates in the back. You can give online, www.ffbcjonesboro.com. And then we have a Dropbox on the office door. In just a few moments, for children fourth grade and under, if you desire, when I get up to preach, you will be dismissed to children's church. You just go through these doors, take a right, and follow the group of kids. Opportunity to worship on a little different level. I started to say a lower level, but understanding kids a higher level, okay, than those of us who remain. I think that may have covered it. Going to pray. Pray that God will show up and show out. Pray that his presence will permeate this place. Pray that he will approve of what he hears and sees, and that he will applaud, because see, it's not about us. It's always about him. Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for the blessed privilege of coming together with brothers and sisters in Christ. Thank you for each one that is here this morning. I thank you for Family Fellowship. I thank you for the guests who are here. I believe we've all been drawn here by the Spirit of God for a unique, sovereign purpose. And I pray that your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I pray the Holy Spirit would move in our midst to minister to our lives. I pray you bless the praise team, anoint them as they lead us in worship, and may our focus truly be upon you. I pray that you'd open our ears to hear what the Spirit has to say. And when it's all said and done, and the final amen is spoken, I pray you will have been glorified. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, let's stand and sing, "As Long As I Have You." Amen.
Thank you.
invite you to take your Bibles and turn to Matthew chapter 7. And then in just a few moments, I'll begin reading in the 15th verse. A couple of things. For those of you that have remarked that you'll take up an offering to make sure that I can purchase razor blades to shave. There is a purpose for that. And I can only say, had you been here Wednesday night, you would understand. So if you don't understand, shame on you. But I have the privilege of returning to Africa beginning February 13th, and I'll be there for a couple of weeks to go back into the village. We had the privilege of seeing natives come to know the Lord Jesus Christ, and where the very first church in West Africa was established. And I've been invited to come back and to teach some of the young believers who are now some of the pastors of that church. And so I look forward to that. And the reason for the facial hair, all the elders, and again, somebody reminded me, and I am one of them, have facial hair. And so I kind of like to fit in. A little different skin color, but I still like to fit in. Guys, really be praying that God will move in power. I said a long time ago, I think the next great awakening, if we are to experience one, will be in Africa. Because the fires of revival have begun to sweep across that land with men and women, boys and girls, in a very anti-gospel setting are embracing the Lord Jesus Christ. And then next, many of you may have seen Nancy come and whisper to me. Many of you know that Nancy's brother, Diane's brother, Miss Amy's son, Phil, is under hospice care and is not doing very well. But they made the determination this morning to take him from the home to the hospice house, and she asked that we just remember them in prayer, that God will be the God of comfort and the God of assurance and peace during this very difficult time. Now, the third thing, I'm going to go ahead and not apologize in the strictest sense of apology. It's kind of like Dr. Adrian Rogers. A woman came up after a sermon, and she was very irate. And she said, "Dr. Rogers, why did you single me out? Why were you preaching to me?" And Dr. Rogers simply responded, "Ma'am, I just shot the arrows out of my bow. I'm not responsible for where they land." And so I will assure you, some things that I will say this morning, some things that I will say over the course of the next several weeks will offend some of you. But I just want you to know, I don't write the mail. I just deliver the mail.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
Okay. So we'll pray that the Holy Spirit will use the series that I call to tell the truth, to minister assurance in your lives as it relates to your relationship as a believer in Jesus Christ. Matthew chapter 7, I'm going to ask that you'd stand and honor the reading of the word of the Lord. Remember, this is not my word, it's not your word, it's his word. Beginning in verse 15, "Beware of false prophets, which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. You shall know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes of thorns or figs of thistles?" Answer that, no, of course not. "Even so, every good tree brings forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree brings forth evil fruit. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Every tree that bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire." Now here's the passage that I want you to grab hold of. "Wherefore, by their fruits you shall know them. Father, because it's your word, I can pray, bless your word. Give us understanding. Pour out in our direction grace to be able to respond to thus saith the Lord. I pray, God, that your will be done in each of our lives. And even as I've already prayed that, Lord, today will mark change. We will not leave here as we arrived here, but crafted a little bit more in the image of your dear Son, our Savior Jesus. Father, forgive me. Cleanse me. Empty me of self. Fill me with your Holy Spirit and preach through me your word for this hour in Jesus' name. Amen.
You may be seated. Amen.
Now, I will figure out just how old some of you really are. A game show from the mid-1950s, continued through the late 60s, introduced three individuals, all claiming to be the same person. However, only one was the real individual. After a period of questioning, the celebrity guest would guess who they believed to be the right one. The round ended with the host saying, "Will the real, whatever, whoever, please stand up?" Of course, you know that game show to be To Tell the Truth. Now listen to me. Not everyone is who they claim or appear to be. And that's true with those who profess to be Christians. The Bible teaches us that not everyone professing the Lord Jesus Christ possesses Christ. And not everyone possessing Christ practices what we will learn is biblical Christianity. In the game of life where the stakes are high, are you real or a sham masquerading as real? This morning and over the next few weeks, applying the scripture, you can tell a tree by the fruit it bears. We will participate in the series To Tell the Truth. But oh my friend, not a game, but life. Not judging others, but examining our own hearts to determine who we really are. And I begin with a question this morning. Is it possible that you could be what I will refer to as a counterfeit Christian? In Matthew 7, 21 through 23, not everyone, guys, say that with me, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied, preached, proclaimed in thy name? And in thy name cast out demons or devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works. And then I will profess, Jesus is speaking, unto them. And I've told you before, some of the most horrifying words in all of the Word of God. I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Here's the case when you think you are, but you're not. When you think you are, but you're not. Counterfeit Christians are often very difficult to discern, as you see in this passage. Sometimes they believe because they believe. You know, they believe in God. They believe in Christ. But they have never exercised biblical faith. There are those of whom James wrote, it's not enough just to believe. Even the demons believe and tremble. But not a single one of them are redeemed. I meet this brand of professing Christians quite often. Rarely are they in the church or even associated with Christian ministry, but are adamant about their belief in God as sufficient to open heaven's doors to them one day. Now here's the problem. Heaven's doors are not opened by them or anything they do, but by the one who holds the keys, Jesus Christ. You can believe in God. You can believe that Jesus is the Son of God, that He came to earth, that He died for the sins of man, was buried, and rose from the dead, and hear me now, and bust hell wide open. You see, believing absent receiving is insufficient to save. Believing something about Christ is different than receiving Christ.
Amen.
And it leaves the one who only believes with a false confidence and a fatal conclusion. The question is not, do you believe? I can find hundreds of thousands of them not far outside these doors. But have you received? Sometimes counterfeit Christians believe they are saved because of their lifestyle, equating goodness with redemption. When asked about their relationship with God, they respond, I've lived a good life. Often pointing out the fact that they've lived better lives than some of the church members that they know. By the way, I hope no one ever uses you as an excuse not to come to faith in Christ. Well, I believe Christians ought to live good lives. Amen? Good living is not God's requirement for eternal life. In fact, Paul said of goodness in Romans 3:10, there is none sufficiently good enough to be saved. No, not so much as one person. Trusting in your goodness does not bring you to God. In fact, it bars you from God. Sometimes counterfeit Christians tie religion to their redemption. They profess, but do not possess. Because redemption is not about religion, but a relationship with God the Father through God the Son. It's not about the church, amen? It's not Family Fellowship Baptist Church. It's about the Christ. It's not about your service. It's about your Savior. It's not about baptism, but the blood of the Lamb of God, which is the only detergent for the stench and stain of your sin.
Amen.
I will never forget a man's family on the day of his funeral presenting me with the man's baptismal certificate and declaring with a smile on their face, now we know our brother is in heaven. Well, here's the problem. I had known the man for 30 plus years and had never known him to profess Christ, never known him to practice Christianity. In fact, he was adamantly opposed to the faith, and he threatened anyone, including me, sharing the gospel with him with bodily harm. And now I'm being asked to tell everyone he's in heaven. Because as a child, he was baptized. In case you're wondering, and I'm sure you are, I said what good I could say about the man, and then I just preached the gospel.
Amen.
Counterfeit Christians often say the right things, believe the right things, and even do the right things. But when they stand before the Lord, they will be turned away. Just a personal question. Could it be that you're a counterfeit Christian? Better to know now, when there's time to do something about it, than to wait until it's too late. You say, I'm not a counterfeit Christian. Well, great. Amen. That's a good thing. But have you ever considered the possibility that maybe you are a part of covert Christianity? In Matthew chapter 13, Jesus speaks a parable. Beginning in verse 24. Another parable put he forth unto them, saying, the kingdom of heaven is likened unto a man which sowed good seed in his field. But while men slept, his enemy came, and he sowed tares among the weeds, and went his way. But when the blade was sprung up and brought forth fruit, then appeared the tares also. So the servants of the householder came and said unto him, Sir, didst not thou sow good seed in the field, your field? And whence then had it now tares? He said unto them, An enemy has done this. The servant said unto him, Wilt thou then that we go and gather them up? But he said, Nay, lest while you gather up the tares, you root up also the wheat with them. Let both grow together unto the harvest. And in the time of the harvest, I will say to the reapers, Gather you together first the tares, and bind them in bundles to burn. But gather the wheat into my barn. Disguised as believers. Well, this is difficult. A part of the church, often unaware that they themselves are enemies of the faith, being used by their commander-in-chief, Lucifer, the devil, to accomplish evil desires. They are in the church, even though they are not a part of the true church. They have an earthly relationship with the church, but not an eternal relationship with the Christ. Now hear this. Tune in. Not everyone whose name appears on the roll of the church is redeemed. Some on the rolls of the church have infiltrated the ranks in order to deceive and to destroy. They are often indistinguishable from the true believer. Even as the parable states, only God can recognize who they are. To accomplish their master's bidding, it's not enough to belong. They must also be in a position to disrupt. I knew a man, sorry to say, a prominent member of the church, that boasted he had personally been responsible for the removal of several previous pastors. Now that's something to brag about, isn't it? And he was. It's what I call a spiritual bully. It was his way, or what? My way. And most of the time he got his way. He met me in the hallway one morning, and after a few choice cuss words, he rang it. I will see you gone. Until the day he died, he led the charge against me. Now, I'm not saying that he was a covert Christian. Remember, I can't distinguish between the wheat and the tares. But if I developed a job description for the tares in the church, he would be the poster child. And while I would discourage you from trying to discover who is and who is not, for fear of destroying one of the true saints, there are some things that you can know about tares in the church to avoid their deceptive and destructive designs. Covert Christians operate in the flesh because they are not filled with the Spirit, resulting in the promotion of decisions denying the power of God and the opportunity to work. They're fond of saying we can't, and then offering several reasons why we can't, without the consideration that God can, because God can do what?
All
things. They are often egotistical, driven by the attitude, what's in it for me? They like the limelight, the accolades, the recognition of others. They are fond of saying, listen to me, rather than, thus saith the Lord God. They are genuinely legalistic, perverting the law for their own desires. They are quick to point out the failures of others, slandering other believers for their faults. And oh, by the way, this is just bonus coverage. Never forget that love covers a multitude of sins.
Amen.
And the question, how can one love God and at the same time display hatred toward another of the family of God, is you can't. Covert Christians present themselves as superior saints in order to sway congregations their way. They're characterized by pride and arrogance, elevating themselves by putting down others. And again, bonus coverage. Remember what the Apostle Paul admonished the believers in Rome, to live a humble existence by putting others on the pedestal. They weaponize the tongue, spewing gossip in order to defeat those who would oppose them. Their conversations often begin with, oh, I love fill in the blank such and such, but have you heard? Not so far in my past, I knew a man that presented himself as a defender of righteousness. He spent much time criticizing the pastors and the members of the church he attended. He twisted the word of God in order to accuse the church's leaders and laity of wrongdoings. I can only say of this man that according to James, his tongue was set on fire of hell for the purpose of destruction. And he may indeed be a covert Christian. Now pay attention. We're not called to be on the Salem witch hunt. But we are encouraged to be vigilant. Because our adversary, the devil, is like a roaring lion walking about seeking whom he may devour. And he has chose the strategy of working from within. I've said many times, I have never feared the enemy from without. My concern has always been the enemy from within. And don't spend your time looking for those who have infiltrated the ranks of the church, but take note of those who appear to be something different than what they profess. Instead of looking for someone else who may be a covert Christian, I can only encourage you this morning, make sure you are who you claim to be, making your calling and election sure. Which brings me to the final point. And it will be the place that I end in each sermon in this series. Being a certified or a credible Christian. And guys, I'm not sure that there are steps to salvation. But there are certain ingredients involved in the salvation experience. For example, the pollution of sin. When I was born, my birth certificate contained various information. My mother's name, Edwina. My father's name, Morris. My date of birth, January 7th. 1955, and by the way, if that doesn't ring a bell, my birthday was yesterday, and I'm still expecting my presents. My place of birth, Hammond, Indiana. Now, I don't tell folks I was born up north. Don't you go out of here and tell anyone else. My weight. I've come a long way since then. 7 pounds, 9 ounces. Miley, 21 inches. But nowhere on my birth certificate is there the designation of sinner by birth. However, the Bible records of my birth, I was conceived in iniquity. And Paul describes it in Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. I was born, you were born a sinner. No exceptions. To be born in the human race is to be born in sin. And by the way, sin has consequences. The penalty of sin. Romans 6:23, the very first part of the verse says, the wages, what we deserve, the payment, is death. That has been assigned, handed down. That is the verdict of God. The wages of sin is death. Death in a threefold manner. First, there's spiritual death. In Genesis chapter 2, verse 17, you remember the story. God said to Adam and Eve, in the day that you eat of the fruit thereof, you will what? Die. Surely die. They failed to listen to God. And they ate of the forbidden fruit. Now my question for you is, did they physically die? No, not at that moment. But they died spiritually. For in that moment, they became separated from God.
That's right.
But then secondly, there is a physical death. Hebrews 9, 27 says, it is appointed. And by the way, that appointment comes from God. It is appointed unto man, what? Once. To die. And then thirdly, if you die physically, and we're all heading that way, while you are dead spiritually, separated from God, you will die eternally. Eternal separation from God in a place of untold, unimaginable suffering. Revelation 20, 14 and 15. And whosoever's name was not found written in the Lamb's book of life shall be cast into the lake that burneth with fire and brimstone. This is what he referred to as the second, the final death. And that sounds like a lot of bad news, Brother Randy, but I got good news. The results of sin have a remedy, the provision. Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death, but I didn't finish it. The rest of that verse, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, amen, our Lord.
Amen.
And Paul described that also in the book of Romans chapter 5, verse 8, but God demonstrated his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. God's only Son. And I'm glad I don't have to understand it to believe it and receive it. God's only Son died in our place on the cross of Calvary, paying the full penalty for our sin. For him who knew no sin became sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. 2 Corinthians 5:21. God's done his part. That's a hallelujah. What's my part? What is the answer to the question raised by the Philippian jailer in Acts chapter 16? Sirs, what must I do to be saved? The plan of salvation. I turned to a lot of passages of scripture, but let me just share with you from the book of Acts chapter 20, verse 20, 21. And how I kept back nothing that was profitable unto you, but have showed you and have taught you publicly and from house to house, testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks. Two things. And we know he taught many other things. And what Paul is saying is, I told you the two things necessary to have a relationship with God the Father through God the Son. And here they are: repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. The plan, number one, repent. Now, I know that's an ugly word, but it's a biblical word. Repent. Turn from your sin. Choose to abandon the old way of life and begin a new way of living. That's repentance. No longer living for self, living for the Savior. Amen. And here are the words of Jesus in Luke 13:3 and repeated in verse 5. Except you repent, you will likewise perish. But the second part of the plan, believe. Believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He wasn't just a man. He wasn't just a good man. He wasn't just a great man. He was the Son of God. God manifested in the flesh. Believe that he became a man in order to die for the sins of man. Believe that he died and was buried. And then on the third day, rose from the dead. That's what you believe. That's the plan. That's the plan. Repent and believe. But there's one final step without which there is no salvation. Everything that we've talked about to this point doesn't matter without the final ingredient, the plea of salvation. I call it the heart cry of man. Romans 10:13. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You see, an offer is just an offer until it's been received by the one to whom it has been offered. God's provision of salvation is meaningless until you accept who Christ is and what he has done. Into and as a part of your life. And one more thing, because it goes with what I'm preaching in the series, just to touch on it now, and I'll come back to it much later, the proofs of salvation. 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. Change. Some experience instantaneous change. Some experience incremental change. But you better hear me. All experience change. Christianity is a progression from what we were to what God wants us to be. Conformed into the image of his dear Son, Jesus. Now let me close. You've heard the story before, but let me tell it again. Four men died on the same day, and they stood at the entrance into heaven discussing the sights and the sounds before them. They spoke of one another's merits. At least three of the men that were there. One remained strangely silent and withdrawn. They were met there by the Lord Jesus, who asked them, "Why should I let you into my heaven?" Somewhat set back by the question, Larry, the legalist, began quoting the Ten Commandments. And he expounded a list of all the things that he did not do and all the things that he had done, expecting affirmation and an attaboy from the Lord. However, Jesus only responded, "No man is justified by the law. Depart from me. I have never known you." Not deterred by Larry's rejection, Rudolph, the religious, said with a smile on his face and a wink in his eye, "I was baptized when I was a lad. I was a member of the First Street Baptist Church, the Second Street Baptist Church, the Third Street Baptist Church, the Fourth Street Baptist Church. I faithfully attended all of the services. I sang in the choir, taught Sunday school. I was a faithful tither." "Surely," he said, "if anyone deserves heaven, it's me." Jesus answered, "There is none righteous, no, not one. Depart from me. I have never known you." Then Gregory the Good, somewhat cautiously now, responded, first making sure he had included everything he had ever done. "Lord, I have lived a good life. I've been a good husband. I've been a good father. I've been a good neighbor. I have worked with various charities and have given often to the needy. Why, just last week, Lord, and I'm sure you know, I served food at the local homeless shelter." "Surely, if anyone can pass through the doors into heaven, it's me." Jesus answered, "There is none good, no, not one. Depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I have never known you." And finally, Sammy the sinner, with his head bowed down, he said, "Lord, I'm just a sinner saved by grace. There's nothing about me, nothing I've ever done or not done, that merits for me a place in heaven. I'm not trusting who I am or what I've done. I'm trusting who you are and what you have done. It's not me, Jesus. It's you." Jesus smiled and said, "Welcome home, my child. Enter into the joys of the Lord." Now I finish where I began. Will the real Christian please stand up? If you can't stand, then would you believe and receive Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, I have not meant to be offensive, but I do remember what you said. Your word offends. So, Lord, if someone has been offended this morning, may it be that the Holy Spirit has spoken to them and has revealed to them that not everyone who professes salvation possesses. And Lord, that's not a bad thing. In fact, it can be a good thing, for to realize that I'm a sinner undone, separated from you, without hope in myself, and that you made provision for me when you sent your only begotten Son, Jesus, who died for my sin on the cross and buried and rose from the dead. I have the wonderful opportunity to repent of my sin, to turn from self, and to trust the Savior and be certifiably saved. And so, Lord, I pray today for anyone in this congregation, for those who are watching online who do not have a personal relationship with you through your Son, Jesus, that today could be the day. Father, I pray that everyone will realize this is not the pastor's invitation to the person. This is not the church's invitation to those who sit here. This is your invitation to them. They do not respond to the church. They do not respond to the preacher. They respond to you. And Lord, today, may that response be, Lord, here I am. I come to you. I trust you. I need you. I receive you. In Jesus' name. I'm going to ask that everyone stand. Every head's bowed and every eye closed. Our pastors will be here at the front. The altars are open and available to you. The most important question was asked by Pilate. What shall I do with this one called Christ? And that's the question that I ask you this morning. What will you do with Christ? Well, my friend, you can do one of two things. You can receive him, and I hope you have, or I hope you will. Or you can reject him. That's the options. Receive him. Just a moment.